That's what we all go by anyway, I think, pretty much. So good morning to you. Welcome. It's starting to heat up just a little bit. Just starting to feel just a little bit of the beauty of California this morning. But welcome to you all. I'm glad you're here. Celebrate this Memorial Day weekend with us as we not only celebrate every Sunday the resurrection of Christ, who was the first that I believe that truly gave his life for others with the best motives. Today we also celebrate those who've served this country and given their lives for us. And I know some of you, this is very, very heartfelt because you have family members who have given their lives in the armed forces, given their lives for this country. And so this morning we want to honor those of our family members, those of our people of our country, and as well as those that have served the Lord and given their lives so beautifully for him in his service. So let's start. Let's just open with a word of prayer. You guys join me this morning as we pray, okay? Father God, we thank you so much for this day that you've given us, God. We thank you for not only just the air to breathe and a beautiful new day to celebrate, but all the possibilities it brings, all the things that are still in store yet for so many. God, as we get close in this season of graduations and people who have already graduated from college and in high school in the next couple of weeks, we know that, Father God, they represent that idea that we can do anything, that everything's so fresh before us. But today, God, we also embody that as well, that God, in you are new and fresh every morning, and you carry new destinies for us. And so we celebrate that. God, this morning we thank you for those that have served not only our country, served this nation from the very beginnings, those that, God, we may know of in history, those we may know of in the annals of our own households. But God, we thank you for those that would give of themselves for something so much bigger. They would self-sacrifice their own desires, their own goals, their own dreams, so that we can live this moment in freedom, complete freedom. And so, God, we not only memorialize them, but God, we celebrate them. And we thank you, God, for that spirit of giving and self-sacrifice. And God, we know that that is what you really began your relationship with us in, is a self-sacrificial relationship. And God, we celebrate Christ Jesus today too. And we ask that, Lord God, throughout the valley, as churches are gathering and as they're just spending time in worship, spending time in being family, that God, those that are coming in that don't know you as Lord and Savior, as they walk in and as they sense and understand what this presence of God is all about, the Holy Spirit, knowing that Christ Jesus sacrificed and gave his life for them, that today lives and destinies would be completely changed. Courses of history would be altered because of decisions and relationships that are started today with you. God, that's our heart's desire throughout this city, Madera, throughout our church, that God, you would show up in such a beautiful and big way. And God, we give you all the praise and all the glory for that. And with that, we just get ready to worship and we prepare our hearts, Lord God, to sing before you and worship before you. In your name we pray. Amen. Amen. Would you hug a couple people, shake some hands, and welcome them. Make sure you know the people who are around you. This morning, we have our kids with us. It's a fifth Sunday, so our K through babies are going on back in the nursery, but all of our first through sixth graders are with us this morning, and we welcome you. Bless you this morning as we get ready to worship the Lord. Amen.
that you've shown. It brings refreshing like the rain, and peace floods my heart. I've known nothing apart from your goodness, God. You are glorious. You are holy, holy. The heavens shout that you are worthy, worthy. Oh, oh, oh. Broken the chains, and now joy, it fills my life, your spirit, your light. I'm undone by the kindness of Christ. You are glorious, you are holy. sound of our praise, the heavens will shake and the earth will move. And at the sound of our praise, the heavens will shake and the earth will move. And at the sound of our praise, the heavens will shake and the earth will move. And at the sound of our praise, the heavens will shake and the earth will move. Lift my voice and praise your name. I'll lift my voice. Praise your name. And at the sound of our praise, the heavens will shake and the earth will move. And at the sound of our praise, the heavens will shake and the earth will move. And at the sound of our praise, the heavens will shake and the earth will move. And at the sound of our praise, the heavens will shake and the earth will move. Awesome
that praising Jesus never gets old, never gets boring. He's always moving. He's always doing new things.
Bones are about to move. I feel it on the wind, you're about to ride in. You said that you would pour your spirit out. You said that you would fall in sons and daughters. So come. That you would pour your spirit out. You said that you would fall in sons and daughters. Ask, we'll receive. So we are asking for the greater measure. So like the rain, come drench us in love. Let your power rush in like a flood. We are fixed on this one thing, to know your goodness and see your glory. We're transformed by this one thing, to know your presence and see your beauty. We are fixed on this one thing, to know your goodness and see your glory. We're transformed by this one thing, to know your presence and see your beauty. Come and blow on through, Spirit, move. We're ready for you to come and blow on through. Come and do what only you can do. So come and blow. transformed by this one thing, to know your presence and see your beauty. So come and blow on through. So come and blow on through. So come and blow on through. Do what only you can do. Be lifted higher.
There's a reverence here this morning, and I know that my wife and a bunch from our city, many from our church, a week ago were at the Arlington Cemetery, which is our nation's national cemetery, to honor those who served our country and died overseas on land during the Revolutionary War, during the Civil War. And when you walk that place, I did 2 years ago, there's an incredible reverence, much like what I sense today, of an awe of what has been done for us on our behalf. And we are in a great nation. Regardless of the circumstances and situations our nation finds itself in, it is a great nation. It has had incredible people that have helped shape the foundation of this place. Do you agree? Incredible. You could actually, yeah, you could give them a hand. I mean, those that fought in World War I, those that fought in World War II, and Vietnam, and the Korean War, and Gulf Wars, that continue to give their lives to give us the freedom, even the freedom to think that we've got issues. It's a great nation. But I'm going to tell you something. There's something greater than our nation, and it's the kingdom of God. And it is worldwide. It crosses the boundaries of colors. It crosses the boundaries of flags and of lines on a map. It integrates us with people from all walks of life and all nationalities. This morning, I want to sing this again. I want to sing this. And all the saints and angels bow before his throne. And then I want to go into "He is worthy of it all" again. And I want us to be knowledgeable of not just Jesus Christ, but so many who've gone before in the faith, who've given their lives, that we could be here today in honor and reverence the Lord. Would you all stand this morning? Would you just honor the Lord? Let's sing that. Sing that part one more time.
All the saints and angels,
can you see it?
Bow before your throne.
All those saints who've gone before.
All the saints and the crowns before the Lamb of God.
Come on, sing it this morning with all your life. Come on.
You are worthy of it all.
Yes, you are.
You are worthy of it all. From you are all things. And from you are all things. You deserve.
Come on, let him know he is worthy.
Worthy of it all. You are worthy of it all. From you are all things. To you are all things. You deserve the glory.
Come on, one more time. He's worthy.
You are worthy of it all. You are worthy of it all.
You are worthy.
From you are all things. To you are all things. You deserve.
This morning, I want you to just gather with one another, and I want you to pray for the boldness. I want you to ask for boldness for one another, that you would be able to fight the good fight, that you would be able to stand in this day with all the things that are raging about, whether it's in your workplace, your school, your neighborhood, your family, that you would be that soldier that carries the cross, that fights the good fight of this faith. Would you pray for each other this morning that you would stand, that you would be that one, that example? Let's do that this morning. God bless you as you lead each other and pray for one another this morning. You, Father God, you're so good. And we thank you that you're preparing your people, Lord God, for our end time roles. We thank you, Father God, that we're part of that army. We're part of the warriors, Lord God, that bring a message and do it with love, do it with compassion, do it with mercy and grace. But Father God, yet it's a strong word. It's a transforming word. It's a healing word, Lord God. It's an eternal word. And so, God, we ask that, Lord God, we would not shrink back. We would not be quiet. That, God, as you bring forth words in our mouths, as you bring forth the people to deliver them to, that, God, we would do the things you've called us to do in whatever battle it might seem like, God. It is a triumphant thing that we're a part of. God, we are delivering your word. God, in this day, this age, we thank you, God, for that privilege. This morning, we're going to be receiving tithes and offerings, and so just going to ask God's blessing over it as we get ready to bring it to the front, also in the back. But just agree with me. Father God, we thank you. We thank you, Father God, for the gifts that you bring us. We thank you for, God, not only a workplace, a job, but God, the strength to be able to do that work, the job, the talents, the gifts. God, we pray favor for those who are looking right now to see their job either increase or find a job, Lord, or find a new thing. God, we pray your direction, that God, your people, Lord, would be blessed. That God, they would not only be blessed, but Father God, they would be givers. Not only givers in the things of God and the church, but as they give in this world, that they would give with joy, like we talked about last week. that beautiful joy that is our strength, that we wouldn't, as money leaves us, be holding it back or begrudging it, but God, we would be joyous givers even as we give to sustain ourselves with the things we buy and we use. And God, let us be generous. And God, we thank you for that. We thank you for your prosperity that we enjoy, that brings us health and strength and livelihood and excitement and joy. And all this, Father God, we give you thanks and praise. Amen. God bless you as you bring forth your tithes and your offerings as you give this morning. Amen. Thank you, guys. Bless you. Amen. God's good. Amen. So good. You know, this morning as you came in, as you began to pop in, I noticed a lot of these were gone, so I know that I think that a lot of you got them. But it's our June. Get ahead of myself. I know we're still in May, but here we are with June. Our June calendar of things that are going on, things that are happening. You know, last week, I think Lauren had us at the coast with the Rocky Mountains, the coastline, and the month before that, we were up in the mountains in Yosemite, and now we're on the beach. It's a wonder that after people get our bulletins, anybody even makes it to church, because she's put such lovely scenery and lovely, beautiful landscapes on here for us to enjoy. You know, there are a lot of things that are happening. I'm going to let Charles share a few of those things that are concerning our young people tonight as well as next Sunday. But, you know, this morning as you came in, some of you may have noticed something a little different. We have a lot of our kids in with us. Normally, first through sixth grade, they have a children's church for them. That starts right at 10 o'clock and goes through noon, just like our services. But our kids are in with us on the fifth Sunday. And also, this is a good time for me to let you know and understand the importance that we really believe in our children worshiping with us. And it's a struggle for us sometimes to really let them be gone for all the time that they're gone with on Sundays. So we've also incorporated the month of July. We incorporated it. That's right, the Church Valley West. We made that month. No, just kidding. We've made it so that on the month of July, every Sunday in July, our children and our parents are worshiping together in here in the sanctuary. And now, I know, I get it. There's some parents that sometimes they're like, oh, man, on the fifth Sunday when they realize that it's a fifth Sunday, they're like, ain't no way we're bringing Johnny and Sarah to church with us. They're crazy. They're going to be running up and down. They're going to leave scuff marks on the back, you know, walls, and how they get up on the walls with their feet, I don't know, but they do. And people will trip out. And here's the point. Here's the thing, is that we have to, as parents, learn how to train our kids to honor the Lord and worship the Lord. Now, they do in kinder church, but or in children's church, but because they're all together, sometimes it works easier. They get in here and they get around us, and sometimes they're like, man, I don't know what to do. And so we have to train them what to do. We train them to worship well. We train them to pray. We train them to hear the word of God and to listen. And as pastors, we definitely will make sure that during that month, we will design our sermons, design our messages to help understanding that the entire kids will be in here for that 2 hours of time, and we want them to enjoy that with us. So that's going to be happening during the month of July. So we're giving you a good month's warning to prepare your children and be a part of that. In your bulletins, you see a lot of other things. Like I said, Pastor Charles was going to be talking about baccalaureate a little bit, but we have so many graduates. We had to move them from like underneath the calendar to a whole back panel, man. There's so many, and I know our college graduates have all graduated already. They're all just celebrating that, and we celebrate them as well, and thank them for all their hard work. Recognize that. And so these next couple weeks, we're going to be watching our junior hires graduate and our high schoolers as well. Talking about our graduates and our kids and things, I wanted to do this because I know we have everybody in here and we got a little extra time. Our Sticks team, in just a minute, they're going to be sharing with you a really cool Memorial Day kind of really neat message. And I don't think it goes with Charles' message so much as it goes with this day. I don't know what he's ministering on. But I want to honor a couple of people real quick, and I want to see them. I'm sorry, Ted. Yeah, I didn't get that set up today. It should come right up on there, Tyler, when you go to YouTube, Pledge Allegiance to the Lamb. All of my helpers that have helped out on Wednesday nights with our children's VW Kids Club, we started back in August. And the end of August through September, we've been running something brand new. Last week, we had 65 kids here. It just spiked again, man. I think baseball, some teams are losing. They're getting knocked out, and softball. And so we had an incredible amount of people. But if you helped us at all with any of our events running from the very beginning, cooking to soccer to, I see a lot of our guitar tutors in here today. I saw Abel, I see Rick and Alex, and I know that there were other things that we did, art with Jason and others. If you helped our kids with your gifts, with your talents in our VW Kids Club on Wednesday nights, would you please stand? I want to recognize you. Would you please stand? Yeah, Louie and Terry and Rick and Seth and Becky. And so awesome. Now, if you were a junior high school helper and you helped in the athletics or with these in support, if you helped any time from August till right now, if you were one of our helpers, would you please stand? If you were on Team 414, awesome group of people, and there's even more who aren't here this morning. But I'm telling you, we're getting ready to head into, we got one more week of VW Kids Club, then we head into a week, 4 weeks of H2O. And then we're going to take a big break in July. And we're going to come back in the fall of 2016 with renewed vision and passion. Last week, I went to the Wednesday. Barbara was gone to Washington, D.C. And our junior high school helpers have been helping get ready for H2O. They've been planning it. They're doing all the work. They're planning it. They came up with the themes. They came up with the theme this year, a military theme, the Army, the Navy, the Air Force, Marines, in honor of our forces. And so I was overwatching our Coyotes girls softball team, who won their second back-to-back championship. Emily's not here this morning. She's still partying, but yeah, we'll recognize her next week. And so I'm headed back here, and it starts at 6 o'clock, mind you. We start at 6. But I get things started at about 5:30, and at about 5:10, there's kids, when they see me start to put things out, they start coming over from next door, from the apartments. They start milling over. And so I'm like, I'm at the softball game. It started at 4:30. I'm doing my best. I'm like, I want to see some of this softball game. And, you know, we just went ahead 2-0. And, you know, Charles was there. I'm like, hey, I gotta go. Actually, Charles came in when I left to that one. And I tagged out, came over here. And I knew I was getting back a little late. It was like 5:20, 5:25. So I was going to have to rush around and open up some stuff. And I start to pull in. And I'm not kidding you. If I didn't see 25 kids standing right here where the table should be already up. They're standing around from next door going like, where are these people? What's going on? I am not kidding you. And I want to tell you something in the future as we come forward into the new year, whether it's children's ministry on Sunday mornings, it's Wednesday night ministry with our young people at VW Kids Club, or our nursery ministry that happens on Wednesdays and Sunday mornings, your gifts and your talents and your ability to minister to these kids are not just so that their parents can receive ministry, so their parents are freed up to be able to be ministered to. You are ministering to kids whose lives are changing right before your very eyes. We are watching kids from the neighborhood. And I want to tell you one more thing. Andrea and Kim have ran this thing. We called it the Chill Zone. When I first told Barbara about it, I said, Barbara, we need a place for some kids who don't want to do anything. Because we usually have three things. Right now we have flag football. We have Sticks, which you're going to watch. They've been working on this for 4 weeks. And then we've had computer graphics with Daniel. So there's three things they get to choose. I said, Barbara, we need to have something for kids to go to that don't have any, they're tired, or they've had a long day at school. She's like, no one's going to go to it, Lance. I remember the first Wednesday night, she had like one kid following her around. That was chill zone. And she was walking around seeing everything going on. That was chill zone. And then we started to develop it a little bit more. And then a few more kids started to come. And there was like five or six. And then Kim and Andrea said, you know what? Let's start teaching a lesson. Let's start doing a Bible lesson and a Bible theme. And they started building on it, building on it. Right now, at our chill zone, there's at least 15 kids every Wednesday night that are sitting there choosing to listen to the things of God over flag football, over drama, over anything else. They're saying, we want what they're bringing, what they're giving. And it's, and a lot of these kids are from the neighborhood, too. They're coming over, and this is a part of our gift of the things of God. Jason, can you help pull this thing down? Barbie, can you hand me that list right there? One more thing about our children's ministry. This is kind of really a big month of children's ministry coming in June. We have not only H2O, which is going to be going on four Wednesday nights of the five in June. So we'll have about 100 kids out here getting wet, having fun. But also Kids Camp is coming. And the spaces are all filled, and the volunteers and leaders are all in place. And so now it's just time to finally get their money in and get them ready to go have an incredible time. They're getting a new speaker for the first time, really, in about 3 or 4 years. We've had Rich Hartman for so many years, and now Barbara really felt like it was time for a new voice, a new word. And so we're really excited about that. Those of you who have helped cover the campers, and if you're still making that checkout or getting that, thank you so much for all of the support and the thousands of dollars that have come in from this church body to help. How many kids are going? 45 third through sixth grade kids, 45 third through sixth grade kids, and about 10 to 12 junior high kids. So thank you so much. Next Sunday, after service, very important, a camper and parent meeting. So if your kid's going to camp, they want to spend a little bit of time assuring the parents that they will be okay. They will get to come back. And so that's next week in the chapel right after church. As the team, go ahead, guys, come on up and get set up. As Ted brings them up and as they get in place, you know, we look at Memorial Day, and it's very easy for us to think about our nation, and it's rightly so, and we've talked about that this morning. And for those of you who have served, we know that Memorial Day is more for those that have fought and passed than those that are still alive, and Veterans Day is a day that you're celebrated. But I'm going to tell you today, those of you who have served and made it, we celebrate you too, and we thank you. We thank you for your service. So, when Ted told me he wanted to do this and kind of have it done for this day, I was like, man, this is heavy, Ted. You know, the first person who gave their life for our faith, Christianity, the modern Christianity we know of now, is Jesus Christ himself. The first one that we've really memorialized for giving his life for the kingdom, not for a nation, not for a nation state. But then quickly after was a young man named Stephen. You remember that story? The young man Stephen who wouldn't recant his story, and he was stoned to death, and Saul of Tarsus held the coats. And a lot of you know the story of Andrew, one of the first disciples. He was in the Peloponnese in Greece. He was delivering the gospel, the good news, and they told him to stop, and they imprisoned him, and they took him to a cross. And they said, if you don't recant of this Jesus, we're going to hang you. And he said, I will not only not recant, he said, I demand not to be hanged on a cross like my Savior. Put the cross upside down. I will not be killed in the same way in which my Savior was killed. And then Peter, right afterwards, was crucified on a cross upside down in the same manner, giving his life for everything he believed. There was a man named John Wycliffe in the 14th century. He was a theologian. He was persecuted for his stand against the papal authority. He was not only burned at the stake as a martyr, beyond all recognition, they took his body and his books, and they burned it. John Huss was also a Czechoslovakian priest, and he was burned at the stake. And this is what he said, God is my witness that the things charged against me I have never preached. And in the same truth of the gospel which I have written, taught, and preached, drawing upon the sayings and positions of holy doctors, I am ready to die today. William Tyndale, most known for his translation of the Bible into English, modern English. Tyndale was choked to death while tied at the stake, and then his dead body was burned. Many of you over the last years have witnessed the stories of men like Jim Elliott and the four missionary friends who worked with the Aka tribe in Ecuador, giving their lives on the river beach as they landed that fateful day. So many in the last 5 years or so, you've heard different stories in the Middle East, like the Nag Hammadi massacre on January 7, 2010, when a group of 80 Egyptian Christians were killed as they left their church celebrating Christmas Mass that night. We see it happening not just in the past. We see it happening more so today than we saw 10, 15, 20 years ago. And so these young kids have put together a little drama called I Pledge Allegiance to the Lamb. Go ahead. Thank you. Thank you, guys. Give him one more big hand. Awesome job. That's a heavy, it's a heavy message that they carried for the last month that they've been working on that. Sometimes you go, man, that's bigger than what they should ever have to worry about. But we know in this day and age that our allegiance to him calls us into a lot of understandings of things that are bigger than ourselves. And so it was awesome. Great job, Ted. Thank you so much. Pastor Charles? Yeah. Thank you, Jason. Ready for this guy? Did a great job last week. Loved it so much. Such a good word.
Yeah, awesome. I need to make a couple of announcements tonight. Normally, we do our youth ministry on Sunday nights, no longer in the midweek on Wednesday. So tonight is our youth group night, but it's hot. And so we're going to go swimming. So the Lancasters have graciously opened up their home. So we're going to have a barbecue swim party. But the best part about it is we put together a scavenger hunt. So I'm talking to any teenager here that's in junior high through high school. You guys need to come hang out. There's no school in the morning. If you're going to school in the morning, you shouldn't be. And so we want you guys to come and hang out. There's no cost. It's absolutely 100% free, and it's going to be a great time. So I hope you guys can make it out. If you need an address, just stick around afterwards, and I'll make sure you get that. And it's going to be a lot of fun. The baccalaureate service is next Sunday evening, and this is for specifically for graduating seniors, class of 2016, but it's really open to the community. We're going to be hosting it for, I believe it's our eighth year that we've had a chance to host it. We get people from all over the city coming out, and it's just a chance for the church to honor and to celebrate seniors, and then most importantly, just sort of commission them as they begin to head out into a new chapter of life. And it's really a great opportunity. I know the mayor is going to be here and several others from the city to just sort of love and bless our kids. And then you'll even get a chance yourselves to hear from several of the seniors as they share stories and inspirational moments of their last 4 years and what God has really truly done in their life through high school. So I hope you guys can be a part of that next Sunday night right here, 6:30 p.m. It's really only about an hour service, and I hope everybody in this room makes it a point to get out here. It really is a great time, and I appreciate the opportunity to host it here annually, year after year. A lot of other stuff happening. Our I Am Influence conference is coming up in July. I'm really excited about that, July 22nd through the 23rd. And so I hope you guys kind of pencil that in. And let's get teenagers here and let's do that. Okay, cool. All right. Hey, who's got a Bible this morning? Do we? Awesome. Awesome. We need Bibles at church. Right? We need Bibles at church. I think that would help. I'm told literacy is going down globally. You guys hear that? Literacy globally going down. I read that the other day. But I don't think so. I think we are doing a really great effort to try and bring up literacy, but reading the Bible has always been a challenge. Is it a challenge for anybody else? Is it a challenge? Thank you for being honest, Kirk. Thank you. Good. It's not a challenge. It was for me for a while, but it hasn't been a challenge over the last several years of my life. And I just want to encourage people, just continue to dig into the Word of God. Find that quiet time. Find that place of prayer. And edify yourselves as you grow and prepare yourselves for what the Lord might have for you daily. Daniel chapter 7, verse 9. 14 through 18. We read this last week. I really felt the Lord's been doing something in my life with grace, and I kind of just want to stay in that place of grace. Can we do that this morning? I want to be practical. I want to be applicable, and that's kind of what we want to do this morning. Daniel chapter 7, verse 9 through 14. I saw in the night visions, and behold, with the clouds of heaven, there came one like the Son of Man. And he came to the Ancient of Days and was presented before him. And to him was given dominion. Someone say dominion. Thank you. Dominion and glory and a kingdom that all peoples, nations, and languages should serve him. His dominion is an everlasting dominion which shall not pass away, and his kingdom one that shall not be destroyed. And then in verse 18 of the same chapter, the Lord says, but the saints of the Most High shall receive the kingdom and possess the kingdom forever and ever. I love that. That's you and me. We're the saints of the Most High. And if you're not, get on board. We inherit this kingdom that's going to last forever and ever. But what's wild to me is who's really worthy of this gift? Sometimes I can't even balance my checkbook. And I'm about to get trusted with a kingdom that's going to last forever and ever. Who's really worthy of this gift? There's several of us in this room this morning that would say, man, I don't know if so-and-so is really ready to inherit this kingdom. Right? Jesus knows that all creation belongs to his Father. Jesus knows that the ones who are worthy of this kingdom are the ones that he gave his life for. That's why he did it. And that's all of us. But the ones who get to inherit this kingdom are the ones who actually just say yes. It's really simple, but yet it's very complex. All Jesus wants is everything. That's it. Everything. That's not so bad, right? All he wants is everything. Last week, I talked about a guy named Zacchaeus, who was a tax collector back in the day, city of Jericho, one of the largest cities of its time during this period, known for trading balms and oils, well over 30 to 40,000 people in the city. And of all the people in that city, there was 10,000 to 12,000 men of God, priests. When Jesus showed up, he wanted to hang out with Zacchaeus, the chief tax collector, the one that nobody liked. He didn't hang out with the top preachers of their time. He didn't hang out with the best worship team. He didn't hang out with the intercessors. He found himself the one nobody liked. Called him by name and said, I'm coming to your house. And then used the word, I must spend time with you. Matthew chapter 9:9-13, we see a similar story. But it's not a guy named Zacchaeus. It's a man named Matthew. And as Jesus passed on from there, he saw a man called Matthew sitting at the tax booth. How many of you would not stop at a tax booth? You just kind of, okay. Jesus stopped at the tax booth and he said to him, follow me. Then the next line says, and he rose and followed. That's all crazy to me. Is that crazy to anybody else? That's all crazy. I don't know if Matthew chose to not include the rest of the conversation. I'm not sure. But the Bible was written under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit. And so I'm thinking Matthew thought, listen, if there was more of the conversation, it wasn't necessary. Because when I looked into this guy's eyes and he told me what he wanted me to do, I had to do it. I had to do it. Follow me, Matthew rose and followed him. And as Jesus reclined at the table in the house, behold, many tax collectors and sinners came and were reclining with Jesus and his disciples. Reclining, I believe, is the biblical word for chilling. This is the biblical term for chilling. So Jesus is chilling at the tax table. Many tax collectors and sinners came and were chilling with Jesus. And when the Pharisees saw this, they said to his disciples, why does your teacher eat with tax collectors and sinners? I'm curious what your answer would be. Why does Jesus hang out with transsexuals and atheists? Why isn't he hanging out with T.D. Jakes? Why isn't he out there with Joel Osteen? But when Jesus heard it, he said, those who are well have no need for a physician, but those who are sick, they do. Go and learn what this means. I desire mercy and not sacrifice, for I came not to call the righteous, but to call the sinner. How many of you guys compare your goodness to other people's badness? I'm wondering how many people in this room can stand there and say, man, I'm actually doing pretty good in comparison to. How many of you guys have compared your goodness to someone else's badness? Jesus always hung with people like Zacchaeus. He always hung with people like Matthew and the Pharisees. They could never handle it. Here's why. In the name of hating sin, these men that had committed their whole lives to a scroll and 10 commandments, in the name of hating sin, they actually ended up hating the sinner. And so by doing so, the worst thing that they actually did was they associated not hanging with sinners as being holy. Are you guys catching this? They associated, as long as I am not in the presence of someone who is sinning, I am now holy. I am now righteous. But in the eyes of Christ, that was not so. You guys got to remember, as we were watching this play, it wasn't the sinners that crucified Jesus. It was the men in the temple that wanted him dead. It was the men that spent their whole lives studying the scrolls that asked for him to die. It was not the gays and the transsexuals and the murderers and the pornographers and the liars and the cheaters and the adulterers, on and on and on. It was the holy ones that said, this guy's got to go. So sometimes I think there's a little Pharisee living in my head. Does anyone have a little Pharisee or Sadducee kind of living in their head? Ever struggle with something? You ever struggle with something, then you conquer it, and then you judge others because they haven't?
What's your deal?
I got it. Yeah. You ever feel convicted? And so you kind of begin to look down the food chain, as it were, for someone who's worse off, and then that continues to sort of justify what it is you were convicted of? Oh, man, the Holy Spirit's really, really convicted me here. Then you call up your friend, hey, do you struggle or da-da? Nah, man, I do this. Oh, that's way worse than me. Okay, then I'm doing all right, so I'm going to keep going with what it is I'm going with. We'll make laws and rules to fit our standard of living, then judge others by them. We'll make these rules and laws to fit the way we want to live, create our own gospel, and then we'll begin to judge others' lives by that. And I'm not saying all rules and laws are bad. I'm just saying when they're used in a manipulative way, they can be all bad. You guys remember the Smurfs? I'm going to take a little 1980s detour for a little bit. So I grew up in a time where Saturday mornings was plagued with cartoons on the television. We didn't have one station 24/7 called a Cartoon Network. And anyone parent a child growing up in the 80s and 90s. You guys remember the Smurfs? I was not allowed to watch the Smurfs. Any parents not allow their kids to watch the Smurfs? Who was that? Yeah. Any kids not allowed to watch the Smurfs? Do you remember? You weren't allowed. Tim wasn't allowed to watch. Good. David, no, of course not. You were not allowed to watch the Smurfs. And I'm not trying to crack a joke. I'm just trying to get you guys to where the Smurfs were a mystical creature, and there was a wizard, Gargamel, and I don't got time to get into all the names and what they mean, and I'm not here to break down the Smurfs. I'm here to let you know that Josie Rigby and John Rigby collectively said, our children will not partake of this cartoon. I couldn't watch He-Man because he called to the power of Grayskull. He didn't call to Jesus. I didn't get to watch the Smurfs. All my friends watched the Smurfs. The little blue guys that would run around and everything was Smurferific. I woke up this morning and had a Smurfy day. Ow, I stubbed my Smurf toe. Smurf! I mean, and I wasn't allowed to watch it. Now, I have several Christian friends that were allowed to watch it. And they still love Jesus. They're still going to go to heaven, from what I understand. They're raising their children together as a husband and wife, phenomenal families. I didn't get to watch Smurfs. Am I a better Christian? It's just simple things like that, though, that I think put us in weird positions as men and women of God when we begin to look at rules, laws, and orders. Rules were meant to lead us into relationships and not replace relationships. Laws were meant to lead us into a place of a relationship and not replace the relationship. If we begin to focus too much on the rules or the laws and we focus way too little on the place of grace, all of a sudden we're telling people that I desire more of what you do than who you are. If I wake up every morning, look at my wife and say, honey, if it wasn't for the law, I would murder you. But now I haven't murdered her because I don't want to go to prison. I'm not trying to get some lethal injection in me. But how many of you guys would say, I got an issue? How many of you would agree, we've got a problem? But I'm following the law. I'm following the rules. But your heart's somewhere different. Jesus came to reveal a God who defines us not by our actions, but by his love. Amen? Jesus was obsessed with showing mercy towards those who least deserved it. And most importantly, he was passionate about giving hope to the hopeless. So let's go into Luke chapter 15, and that's kind of where I want to spend most of our day. There's three stories there. I love the stories of Jesus. Don't you love Jesus' stories? Simple, applicable. That's what we're going to do. Today, I want to embrace grace. Somebody say embrace grace. All right. The simplest, I don't know why my eyes are watering. The simplest yet most awkward display of public affection. Anybody want to take a guess of what it is? It's the hug. It's the hug. Can we examine the hug for just a second, really quick? Just really quick. I believe this is the most awkward display of public affection. Because not everybody hugs the same. Not everybody hugs the same. I have done this, family. I have analyzed the hug. There are people who love the bear hug, and they pull you into them, and they snap your back, and you're like, good to see you. There's the side hug. Hey, right? Get a whiff of that armpit. Whoo. There's the hug on the same side you do, and your head's kind of getting, you're like, whoa, whoa. Your head's supposed to go opposite mine. We hug, you go opposite, not same. Opposite. There's the awkward, barely touch hug. Are we gonna? Oh, we're gonna hug. We're gonna do this. Okay. Oh, love you. There's the guy bro hug. Right. Slap the hand. One hand on the back. Open palm or closed fist. Right? Open palm, they're related. Closed fist, they're a homie. There's the robot arm hug. You guys seen that? That's how my nephew hugs. He doesn't even look at you. Right? That's the hug you got to give grandpa when it's time to go. Go give grandpa a hug. Junior high girls are great at hugs. You ever walk on a junior high campus? Go ask Jamie. I don't know where's Jamie sitting, but there she is. Gotcha. If you teach at a junior high or middle school, junior high girls have accomplished the art of the hug. Or at least they're working towards it, because every junior high girl has to hug everything that runs near her or walks by her. So I assume she's practicing her hug because she has not worked it out yet. Did anyone raise that junior high girl? I've been doing youth ministry now for over 10 years, and I have learned that junior high girls, they work very hard on the hug. So I've spent a lot of time looking at this hug, right? The simplest yet most awkward form of public displays of affection is this hug. So when grace comes, we sort of act like an awkward hugger. All of a sudden, grace falls into our lives. God offers us something that's really too good to be true. And we kind of, we don't really know how to handle it. Grace is unearned. Grace is unmerited. Grace includes total forgiveness. It feels and looks like the awkward hug coming your way. And you don't sometimes know what to do with it. I totally forgive you for everything you did in my life. What? Really? But I really hurt you. I really offended you. Sometimes grace will come and we just sort of stand there and let it happen. What is happening? You're receiving grace. What do I do with it? Webster's dictionary defines grace: a charming or an attractive trait or characteristic, approval, favor, a title or an address, a short prayer at a meal. Sorry, I thought that was funny too. Short prayer at a meal. Shorter the better. I wrote this down. This is sort of Charles's definition of grace: unmerited divine assistance giving humans for their regeneration or sanctification. So let's look at Luke chapter 15. Several stories right here. There's three stories. What I love about these stories are all of them have to do with losing something. And most importantly, ending with a party. If you are 20 years old and your friends are clowning on you because Christians don't know how to party, open them up, your Bible, to the Luke 15 and say, look, Jesus loved a party. Jesus partied when you lost even a coin. Jesus threw a party. So let's take a look here. Let me fill you in on some context really quick. So Jesus is hanging out with sinners again. Crazy, right? This guy, what's he doing? He's hanging out with a bunch of sinners. He's in the Middle East. The religious people, they don't like it. And Jesus tells three stories. The first story, I won't go into too much detail about it. Let's just sort of review. I think we've all heard this. It's a story about a lost sheep. Anybody heard this story before? It's a story about a lamb that goes astray from the group. And the shepherd is worried about this lamb. And the shepherd actually leaves the other sheep to go and find this one. The Bible says this, that there is more joy in heaven over one lost sinner who repents and returns to God than over 99 others who are righteous and haven't strayed away. Anyone remember when you were the one? Okay, good. Good, good, good. Let's look at the second story. Really quick, this woman loses her coin. I lose my keys daily. Is anyone else that person? I lose my wallet at least 3 times a week. I will go days without my wallet. Days. And my wife freaks out. Well, shouldn't you call the credit card company? I'm like, babe, it's going to pop up. I don't know when. And then sure enough, there it is. In that jacket, in that pair of pants, underneath the car seat, oh, wedged into the couch. It's usually my son now who finds it. I thank God for my son. Usually he's losing stuff, but my wallet, he'll find it, just crazy spot. Dad, what? I'll go days without my wallet. I save a lot of money. She loses this coin, but my favorite part about this story is read how excited she gets when she finds it. Family, I'll drop a quarter in the parking lot and then drive away. Right? If it's paper money, I'll pick it up. If it's a coin, congratulations, 5-year-old kid that finds it. This woman loses a coin, freaks out, begins to look for it, and when she finds it, the joy of when it's found. Now, the story I want to kind of focus on is the story of the prodigal son. How many of you guys have heard this story before, the prodigal son story? So when I read this story, I read it over and over and over and over and over. And we've all read it so many times to where we could probably rehearse it. And, you know, wouldn't skip a beat. But this morning, I kind of want to read it from a different perspective, and let's just begin. Verse 11. And he said, there was a man who had 2 sons, and the younger of them said to his father, Father, give me my share of property that is coming to me. And he divided his property between them. Not many days later, the younger son gathered all he had and took a journey into the far country, and there he squandered his property in reckless living. Verse 14, and when he had spent everything, a severe famine came across the country, and he began to be in need. Verse 15, so he went and hired himself out to one of the citizens of that country, who sent him into the fields to feed pigs. And he was longing to eat with the pods that the pigs ate, and no one would give him anything. But when he came to himself, he said, how many of my father's hired servants have more than enough bread, but I am here perishing with hunger. Verse 18, I will arise and go to my father, and I will say to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and before you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Treat me as one of your hired servants. Does that break your heart? Okay. Verse 20, and he arose and came to his father, but while he was still a long way off, someone say a long way off. While he was still a long way off, his father saw him and felt compassion and ran and embraced him and kissed him. Underline and ran. Underline and ran. And the son said to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and before you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. But the father said to his servants, bring quickly the best robe and put it on my son, and put a ring on his hand and shoes on his feet, and bring the fattened calf and kill it, and let us eat and celebrate, for this my son was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found, and they began to celebrate. Party time. I'm going to stop there. Continue to read the story as you wish, but I kind of just want to stop there for just a second. 3 stories, 3 things lost, all 3 things found, essentially, 3 parties. These were stories that Jesus told so that we'd understand that the Father loves bad people and rejoices when they return to him. These are the stories that Jesus would tell. Now, what I love about this is what the son wasted money with great extravagance. Here's my thing. If I were to go to my dad, at assuming this young man's age was within somewhere between 15 to 20, is what I'm guessing, and say, Dad, can you imagine your 16-year-old? Dad, can I have my inheritance now? You guys would laugh.
You'd be like, ha-ha, right, right. Go clean your room. Go wash the car.
Why not?
Because I said so.
All right, that was the answer I got a lot. No explanation needed.
Dad said so.
So as I'm reading this story, But for some reason, this dad did it. I know no father that would give a 16-year-old an excess amount of money and entrust that 16-year-old. And then even when the 16-year-old packed his things and said, I'm going to another country, that father would be like,
we'll see you, my son.
I know a lot of dads that say, walk out that door, don't come back.
You're going to learn today. Be a real man. Right?
I know a lot of dads that would do it like that. For some reason, I didn't read that part. Did I skip it? Does anyone else got that part in their Bible? What did the sheep do to be found? What did the sheep do to be found? Now, when I had a chance to share this story with our youth group, and I got a young man in our youth group that raises sheep, and I asked him, I was like, how smart are sheep? And he just laughed for about 8 minutes. Further allowing me to understand and realize that the sheep are not so bright. In fact, arguably one of the lesser, we'll say dumber animals on the food chain. It's why we eat it. What did the sheep do to be found? That sheep did nothing. That lamb did nothing to be found. Arguably was probably just eaten. And then the shepherd showed up. Oh my gosh! Oh! Yeah, your dog ever get out of the house? I remember our dog got out of the house one time. We spent hours driving around looking for our dog. As soon as we found it, my wife kicked open the door, ran into the middle of the road on her knees, holding the dog, weeping. Oh! Same dog she yelled at last night and kicked out of the. But I can just imagine the sheep had no recollection it was even lost. The sheep had no idea what. The sheep was just being sheep. This young man is in a desperate place. And he even says, look, this is what I got to do. Okay, this is what I got to do. I'm going to write this letter. I'm going to come. I got this speech prepared. I got the I'm no longer worthy speech prepared. Did you guys ever need something from mom or dad and you would practice your speech as to how it was you were going to get what it was you wanted from them? Do you remember being in that place when you needed 20 bucks from mom and dad, when you needed them to say yes about something, when you needed to borrow the car and you came up with you got the I'm very responsible speech ready to go? This son's practicing the I'm not worthy speech. He's trying to hit all the points. All right, Pops is going to say, yeah, but you spent all this money. I'm not worthy. I'm not worthy to be your son. Make me your servant. What? I couldn't imagine going to my dad and saying, please, if you don't make me your son, at least just make me your servant. I've got two boys. I've got two kids now. What happens when one day they come up to me and they, you know, I can just picture Roger coming up to me. Pops, I did it! I'd be like, what'd you do? I'm worthy to be your son. You see, because if he does that, I'm going to have to laugh at him probably. And I'm going to have to tell him to go and eat the dinner that I bought. Then I'm going to tell him to go put on and clean the clothes that I also purchased. Sleep in the bed that I bought underneath the roof of a house that I paid the mortgage on. So he can wake up and drive in the car that I'll probably be paying for, the gas that I pay for to take him to the school, riding with the utensils that I probably paid for. Because, you see, my son, how do I say this? what makes my son worthy to be my son was the fact that he was born. Being a son or daughter has nothing to do with being worthy at all. In fact, it has to just do with being born. That's why we become born again. Because you can't work your way to Jesus. You can climb the highest tree, Zacchaeus. But the bottom line is Jesus knew he was going to be hanging out with Zacchaeus before Zacchaeus even thought about climbing the tree to see Jesus. You see, my sons are my sons because they were born to me as their father. Spiritual birth happens by grace. You can read Ephesians chapter 2, 8 through 9. For by grace you have been saved through faith, and that not of yourselves. It is the gift of God, not of works, lest anyone should boast. Do you remember that part that I asked you to underline in the story of the prodigal son? While he was still a long way off, he ran. We can get educated, we can plan, we can work. But the bottom line is that we'll never get to God on our own because he sees us a long way off. He sees you. He's like, what you doing working so hard over there? I see you. Yeah, but I'm a long way off. I'm nowhere near you, God. I'm nowhere near where I want to be. I'm not close enough to touch you yet. I'm working hard. I'm trying to educate. I want to be a man of world knowledge, and I want to figure this Jesus guy out. Yeah, good luck with that. I see you. I got eyes. I'm looking. I wonder what it looked like as this father would walk out to the front of his home and just sort of look across his countryside. I wonder if he would walk out the dusty road to the end of his property and just sort of gaze over the countryside, wondering what day his son was going to come home. I know that's what I would probably do. If my son were to run out of my house, I would probably always, every time I heard the door open, you just kind of look, you know? I wonder how many of this man's friends had come over, partied with him, or enjoyed, and then the dad would say, I'm going to take a little walk. I'm going to see if my son is coming home. I wonder how many of your friends said, what are you doing? Dude, that son, he embarrassed you. He left you. Because you've got to remember the type of people Jesus was talking to here. First of all, how many of you guys knew that this was actually a story that was told by Jews to scare Jews from conforming to a Gentile or Roman lifestyle? The original version of the prodigal son actually ends with the son dying and not coming home. And the Jews would tell that to their children as a way to prevent them from doing anything that was against the custom or the culture of Judaism. Do you guys know that? So they would tell the story as a way of, this is what happens when you try to live the lifestyle of the Romans, of the Gentiles. This is what happens. So then the kids would go, oh, well, we don't want to do that. We don't want to leave our parents and squander our inheritance. Let us be good Jewish boys and girls and stay amongst our family and live within our culture. Leave it to Jesus to take a cultural story and flip the script. Then he flips it one more time. The father ran when he saw his son. So, Ken Bailey, who's the author of The Cross and the Prodigal Son, he explains that if a Jewish son lost his inheritance amongst Gentiles and then returned home, the community would perform a ceremony that was called a kizaza. And in this ceremony, the son would sit in a chair and the community, the community of people would break a giant pot in front of him, and as they broke the pot in front of him, they would all yell at him, you are cut off from your people. And then that child, the community would totally reject him. The father sees his son and runs out to him. Two things. The father knows what's about to happen if that son makes it to the community before the father does. This ceremony was going to take place, and his son would be forever banished from the community. The second thing, the father is doing something that is completely shameful in this Middle Eastern culture. Men did not run in this culture. They did not run. Here's why. In order for them to run, they would have had to have hiked up their cloak so they don't be tripping on those sandals. They hiked up their cloak and they would run. That would mean they would have to expose their legs, which is a big no-no, very shameful. This father didn't care. He didn't care. He would rather shame be put upon him than on his son, because he knew what would happen if his son made it to the community before he made it, because only a father could restore this boy to his rightful position as a son. Because if he were to return to the community would have judged him by what? Their laws and rules. So this boy, he had already said it in his heart, he didn't care. He didn't care. Anything was better than being where he was. And as he shows up in front of his pops, he starts going through his speech. Dad, I'm so unworthy. And his dad didn't even let him finish the speech. I just picture tears in this father's eyes. I just picture this father embracing him. First of all, the kid was probably shocked that this man's running at him. Because again, you just didn't see it. It never happened. Men did not run in this culture, especially a man of this stature. And as his father standing before him, probably tears in his eyes, he embraces him. The servants are probably wondering, why is the master running? This is crazy. And when they get out there, they recognize that it's his son. And this man gives order to his servants, treat my son in this manner. The conversation didn't go down. Father stood in front of the house and waited for boy to come crawling back to him and then go, I told you so. Come on, how many would probably have that conversation? Right? Wife sees son coming up. No, 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 honey. Don't open the door. Let him knock. If he's a man, right? Oh, now you want to be a little boy. Now you want to be a boy. How many guys, that's how that conversation would probably go, right? Because you understand, the boy has squandered inheritance. Not a couple $100. Inheritance, property, value, land, worth. Not only to mention, he's probably embarrassed your namesake, which culturally was a huge no-no back in the day. Doesn't that dad deserve to get a piece of that boy for all the dishonor and disrespect that this man has worked hard for, that generations have worked hard for? You got to remember, we're talking a Jewish culture of generations upon generations, passing down land, passing down inheritances and inheritances. And this one kid decides, hey, I want mine now, and I'm going to go and do whatever I want with it. And he messed it all up. And then has the audacity to come back home? Doesn't this father get a right to at least get a little say in this? But in my Bible, I don't read how that conversation went down. It's not there. And the father lit into his son and told him what was best. And the son wept with embarrassment. Does your Bible say that? Does anyone have that line where it says, and the son wept with embarrassment and shame as his father told and pointed out of all the bad things that he had done? Anybody got that version? Because if you do, you're probably reading the wrong word of God, because that's not the character of our father. The character of the father is that he would rather shame himself than shame you. The character of our father is he would rather allow himself a little skin to show while he ran after his son or daughter. Did you know that the reason why Jesus went on the cross was so that he would be shamed and not you? Jesus didn't want you to get spit on. Jesus didn't want you to get called a heresy. Jesus didn't want you to have to go through the pain of sin and suffering. So he said, I'll be the good dad and I'll go through the suffering. I'll go through the shame. You won't have to. And I won't remind you of all the shame and suffering that I went through for you. But like an awkward hug, we stand there and go, thanks, Jesus. Thanks, Jesus. That's a weird hug. I don't know what to do with it. So I'll say amen. Amen. But I don't really know what to do with it. Because the enemy is so good at what he does best, which is remind you of all the stuff that you've done. Remind you of how unworthy you are of this grace, how unworthy you are to receive this inheritance, which is a kingdom that will last forever and ever and ever and ever. You see, Jesus was trying to communicate one thing and one thing only to this group of sinners from the Middle East that were sitting there, and their culture was just being rocked right now. Their culture was just being rocked right now in this story. In the story, the culture was just being rocked. Jesus was trying to communicate crazy love. That's all he was trying to communicate. Even in our darkest moments of sin and self-centeredness, God will still love us. You have to remember that the Son deserved absolutely nothing of the Father. The Son deserved absolutely nothing of the Father, but the Father gave him everything again. Again, the sheep deserved nothing of the shepherd, but the shepherd went out and still gave. It seems too good to be true, and it really is because it is. That's grace. It is too good to be true. That's grace. I'm going to have Alex come back up. So, the dice you roll when you teach grace to teenagers is you run into that teenager that says, well, then I can mess up all I want. The grace of God will forgive me. And I've talked to those kids over and over. I've talked to those kids. And the only way I can communicate where their theology is a little miscued is that they hold grace as if it is a theology. They hold grace as if it's some type of dogma. Grace is not a theology, family. Grace is a person. Grace is Jesus. When you look into the eyes of Christ, really look into the eyes of Christ, the last thing you want to do is break that grace, is take advantage of that grace. Because here's how it works. If you're sitting next to somebody, look into their eyes. Come on, turn to the person next. Just look into their eyes. Don't get goofy. Don't get crazy. Guys, this is a great time to hit on a girl. Look into their eyes. Just take. No, you're not doing it. Come on, look in their eye. Betty, look in their eye. Come on. Just look in their eye. Come on, Mr. Don. Come on, look at that. I haven't said stop. It's awkward, isn't it? Keep looking. Is it awkward? Is it awkward? Here's why it's awkward. Because the longer I gaze into their eyes, the more of a connection that I actually get. And the more of a connection that I actually have, then the more accountability and responsibility I feel towards that person. And now all of a sudden, it becomes harder for me to do something against them, to break them, to hurt them, to disgust them, because I now have intimate connection. When you look into the eyes of Jesus, the last thing you want to do is make up some false concept of what grace really is to fulfill your selfish desires. Because when I look into the eyes of Christ, I look into grace. And when I find grace, the last thing I want to do is leave it, hurt it, break it, take advantage of it. So when people say, man, I can just sin and grace will forgive me, I say, listen, you don't even know what grace is. You have no concept of grace. You've never met grace, because when you meet him, the last thing you'll want to do is hurt him. And when you do, you find yourself running back with your little speech, forgive me. I don't deserve to be your son. But Jesus, I'll take whatever you got open right now. Just let me in the room. Just get me in the house. Just get me in the place. The more I encounter Jesus, the more grace I encounter. With the more grace that I encounter, the softer your heart becomes, the more patient you become. And the more you begin to realize, it's not about rules, it's not about laws. These are the things in place to get my relationship closer, but it doesn't replace relationship. The more I spend time with the Father, the more I realize it's about who you are and not what you do. As people, as humans. That's why, to me, hope is alive in America. Because I think more people are encountering Jesus like never before, and they're experiencing great places in grace, great places in forgiveness, great places in passion, in intimacy, and hope is alive. In that place of honor. I'm a city council member, and this is the first time, and I believe over a decade, that we've seen as many presidential candidates stop in the Central Valley as they have this year. I went to the Donald Trump rally on Friday morning, not because I'm a supporter, because I'm curious. So I'm trying to educate myself as an American voter. My heart broke. Not because of what the man on the podium said, and I'm not letting people within his crowd represent who he is. Some of those people in that crowd they got no grace, got no hope, got no mercy, because they don't act in a place of honor or from the place of honor. And not just the people that I was in line with or in the auditorium with, even the people with their signs, some of them. I'm not letting one represent all. But what it seems to me, and the answer was clear, is that there are hurt people in America. And I'm not saying that a man's gonna solve our issues or a woman's gonna solve our issues. I'm saying that Jesus can. And the avenue that he has chosen to change the earth is by partnering with you. Because you're the one, when it's all said and done, that he's going to hand the keys to. Dominion belongs to you. Dominion belongs to you. Dominion belongs to you. Dominion belongs to you. So we might as well practice now what it feels like to have that dominion. Let's just stand this morning. Jesus, I pray that you would pour out your Holy Spirit this week, that we would begin to operate from the place of grace, that we would begin to operate from the place of honor. Lord, I pray that we would have a better understanding of what it is to embrace grace, that when a man or woman forgives us or reaches out and says, I love you, that we would embrace it, understand and realize that this is the the way the Father wanted us to operate. I pray even this morning that if there's one here that feels like they're on that journey, that they're trying to find their way back home, that they feel like they've squandered everything, they feel like they've been living lost for so long, and they just want to come back to Dad. I just want to go back home. I want to go back where I feel safe, where I feel secure. I pray this morning that that heart would find Jesus running at them, saying, my daughter, it's been too long. My son, I've been waiting for you. I will hold your shame and guilt so you will never have to experience what it feels like. Jesus, I pray that we would champion other Christians to walk from the place of grace, to walk in the place of mercy. I pray, God, if we have built rules and laws and orders that have replaced the place of intimacy with you, the way you ripped the curtain to the holies of holies, would you rip those rules and laws that are keeping us from experiencing the love and compassion that Jesus died on the cross for? May we find it a worthy place to sit amongst sinners, that we would not conform to their style or their lifestyle, but that we would be courageous and bold enough to love through sin, that your power would abide in us. Father, I pray that this week that we would experience you in a new and amazing way. Holy Spirit, that you would go with us, that you would talk with us. I pray that you would release gifts in the prophetic and the words of knowledge, that we would see gifts of healing demonstrated through this body, that the word of Jesus Christ would be shared throughout the city of Madera, Fresno, Clovis, the state of California, and throughout the nations of the earth. I thank you, God, that you're a Father who loves me regardless of what I have done, what I've said, and that someday I will receive an inheritance and dominion of this earth will be ours. Amen. God bless you guys this morning. Have a great 3-day weekend. We'll see you back here on Wednesday. If you need prayer this morning, if you just want to meet at the altars, I will be available, as well as our senior pastoral staff. God bless you guys so much.